For someone who at least understands the what to do of adding fractions or the how of adding fractions, okay, the most superficial level of adding fractions is the how and what to do. How do you do it?
You find the common denominator.
All right, we'll stay right there. We need a common denominator. Okay, what part of the fraction is the denominator? The bottom part of the fraction is called the denominator. Why do the denominators of fractions need to be the same in order for you to add them? This will also answer the question of why don't they need to be the same when you multiply them. Okay, so why do they need to be the same when you're adding them or subtracting them?
You need to have two common things.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, but we're going to discuss what is common about them. It's not common like this is a desk and this is a desk and I am together to have two desks. Right? It's not just what they are, like what we call them, right? When we're talking about fractions. Marcus is right. I mean, they are the same kind of thing, but what makes them the same is not just what we call them. What makes them the same when we have the same denominator is what?
Exact.
Exactly the same. What is exactly the same about them? It's not just their name. It's not just like just that's a desk,
how
that's
much
a dog, that's a thing. What?
How much are they?
How much, you say? Okay. Jasper?
Same amount?
Okay. Here, let's find the common denominator. Maybe it'll be easier to talk about it. Okay? So what will the common denominator be?
12.
And how will we get this to have a denominator of 12?
You times 4.
Okay. Now let's just talk about this real quick. Could this be correct?
No.
Why not?
Because we need the same on both sides. Or like
top and bottom.
You're talking procedural, you're talking about what to do. I'm talking about why. Why can they not be the same? Why can this not be correct?
Is it improper?
Not because it's improper.
Is it because you did times 4 but 3?
We're talking about procedural. We're talking about just because you didn't do this thing or you were supposed to do this other thing. Why do I know? Why can I look at this and know that this cannot possibly be right?
Hope?
Let me ask you this. Should this and this be the same?
Yeah.
In what way should they be the same?
So they should be once
they should be the same
two
number.
Reduce, over 12, it's not 2/3, it's 1/6.
Okay, so now we're getting to, they should be equal, right? There should be some way to prove that this is equal to this, okay? This is getting more to the why. Why can this not be right? How do I know that I found the common denominator incorrectly? Because this number needs to be equal to this number, and it's not, okay? It's not. I'm not looking for answers of how to get it that way. Okay. Marcus has got an answer of, well, if we simplify this, if we divide these both by a factor of 2, then it does not make 2/3. It makes 1/6. So there's a way we can prove that they're not equal. That's good. Is there another way that we can prove that these cannot possibly be the same number? It starts to get at why we need common denominators and what the denominator means here. Someone to explain it to me like I am a fifth grader, why 2/3 and 2/12 can't be the same number. Yeah?
Because they don't have the same digit. They don't have the same value.
Do you mean I'm a fifth grader, I work in a lot of concrete terms, meaning like you're going to show me how 2/3 is not the same as 2/12. Well, is 3/4 and 6/8? Those numbers are different, so those numbers aren't equal to each other? They are, right? So it's not because just their numbers are different. To a fifth grader, who usually has to like hold things in their hands, how can I understand that 2/12 and 2/3 can't possibly be the same number? two-thirds is more than 2/12.
Greater than.
Greater than, bigger than. It's, okay, so 2/12 is smaller than 2/3. Okay? Can you show me that with physical objects, why 2/3 is bigger than 2/12? What does 2/3 look like?
You want to draw it up there?
You want to come draw it?
Sure.
You draw it there and there?
I'll draw.
Try that? Okay. So Marcus is going to show us 2/3, what 2/3 looks like.
Just press on the pen. This button right here. That one.
No, you're on the eraser.
That one.
That button makes it the eraser. And the other button makes it the pencil.
Alright,
so we'll just assume that's a circle. Alright, now we're looking at.
So 2/3 is basically
that.
This row right here. That's 1/3.
The unshaded part is 1/3, and the shaded part is 2/3.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, just a whole circle. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 12. I can't draw this here.
Do you want me to do it?
Yeah.
Okay. I see what you're getting at, and I totally agree. This is a good way to show a fifth grader what 2/12 looks like. Let's take a whole thing. Okay, let's do that. Cut it like that, and like that. Like this. Okay. So what? Where is 2/12 in all of this?
The shade.
There's two of them. Okay. Can this fifth grader now see why 2/3 and 2/12 can't be the same number?
Yes.
Because what can you say about a 12? A 12 is smaller than? Well, a 12th is smaller than a 1/3. And it's still certainly smaller than 2/3. We have two of these things and two of these things, but these things are?
They're bigger.
Bigger than these things. Okay? By having all of this discussion, we are getting to why we need a common denominator. Because the denominator tells us what about the pieces? Well, the common denominator does, but the denominator of this fraction, what does it tell me about the pieces?
There's 12.
This number does? Right here that I'm pointing to? There's three. There's three of them? If I have three of them, then what can I make with those three pieces? Kelly, if I have three of these thirds, what can I make? I have three of these things.
Pi.
How many pi?
One.
Exactly one? No more, no less?
Three? I don't know.
When I ask you a question, doesn't mean you're right, doesn't mean you're wrong. I'm just asking you to clarify and to be sure about what your answer is.
Yes.
So if you have three of these guys right here, can you make, how much pi can you make?
Three.
Three pies?
One.
One pie?
One.
Is it three or is it one?
One.
Exactly one?
Yes.
No more than one, no less than one?
No.
Okay, right, it's exactly one. We can make, with three of these things that are size 1/3, we can make one whole piece. That's what the third means. That's what the denominator means. It means how big is this piece? How big is this piece? Let's please put away anything that's not our math notes. So we're starting to get at it. I don't know. Yeah, I'm trying to find a common denominator. Made a bunch. Oh my gosh! I just erased the fractions.
Uh oh.
I'm gonna erase the word fraction.
Back to the fraction.
Okay. So multiply by four.
Back to the future.
You got a 12 here. You gotta multiply this by 4 as well. So then if we simplify this fraction, if we, I don't like the word reduce, but a lot of people use it. If we do that, we'll get 2/3 back. We divide both the numerator and denominator by 4, we get 2/3 again. Let's put everything away that's not our notes. Okay. And we can make this into 12s by multiplying this by 3 and this by 3, and we have 15/12. Now we have common denominators, and we can add them together, because the denominator is the same, and what does that mean about these pieces?
They're the same.
What's the same about them?
The denominator.
Pieces don't have denominators. If I take a piece of pie,
amount.
I don't think about denominators.
Nope.
So what does this tell me about the piece, this piece right here?
There's 12 of them.
It takes 12 of them to make what?
One pie.
Okay. It takes 12 of these size pieces to make a whole whatever, pie, lasagna, whatever, it doesn't matter what it is. Okay? It takes 12 of them. So this tells me the size of the piece. If it takes 12 to make the whole, those are pretty small. If it takes 56 of them to make the whole thing, those are even smaller. If it takes 2 of them to make the whole thing, those are halves. Those are pretty big compared to 12s and 56ths. Right? Those are fairly large. It tells me how big the piece is. So now these things are the same size. Okay? Not just this, like apples and oranges. Not just like that, because that's just, apples is what we call it. Orange is just what we call it. Okay. I need to add apples to apples because, well, they need to be the same thing. We add together. What's the same about these is how big they are. Okay. So how big they are. So we have 8 of these things that are size 1/12, and 15 of these things that are size 1/12. So how many of these 1/12s do we have?
23.
Now, altogether, if we add the 8 of those to the 15 of those, we have 23 of those 12s. That's the right answer. Okay, that is how many 12s you have, whether or not you write this as 1 and 11 12ths. Could it be more like beside the point? The point here is we're adding fractions together. We get a common denominator. Why?
Equal.
What about them is equal? The size. They're the same size. Okay?
They're the same size.
If we don't get a common denominator, we add these together and we get 7/7. Okay, because we forgot to add fractions. Then the only hope for us is that somebody's looking over our shoulder and tells us, hey, you need a common denominator. Oh, I remember how to get common denominators, and you get them. If instead you know that you need these things to be the same size, when you go to add them together and you're like, oh, 7/7, so wait, I have 7/7. I don't think that's right. That means that I have 1. I don't think I have 1 here. I think I have like a lot more than 1. In fact, we find the right answer, we have almost 2. Okay. So if you're adding the numerators and denominators together, you're not giving any thought to why, like what's going on. What am I actually doing to add this together? When I'm collecting, they need. What size are we going to make these and these?
18.
That's right.
18.
We're going to make them of the size that 18 of them make a whole. Okay. If we had these 5/6, 1 of them, 2 of them, 3 of them, 4 of them, 5 of them, okay. We'll cut each of those into how many pieces to make 18ths?
Half.
Cut them in half?
Mm-hmm.
These ones? If I get
a
third.
Oh, third.
It's a third. 1, 2, 3. Now how many pieces make up the whole thing?
18.
It takes 18. How many of those things do I have? Well, I only have as many as I shaded
15.
In.
15. 15 out of 8.
You have 15. You had 5 of those 6.
19.
And you 15. Cut them into pieces, right? Cut them each into 3 pieces. We have 18 that make a whole, and 15 of those are how many we have. Okay. If we had 2/9, we got we have ninths, we'll cut each of, oh sorry, we'll cut each of these ninths into how many pieces to get eighteenths?
Half.
I did ask how many pieces, and the answer is two pieces, right? Cut each of these pieces into two pieces. So we cut them into two pieces. We had two ninths to start with. I guess I should have, that's one, two ninths. Oh, I had two ninths, not two thirds. There's a third, and there's a ninth, and there's a ninth. Okay, so when I count to 18ths, I have 4 18ths. We have 15 18ths plus 4 18ths. Now we can add them together because
they're equal.
They're the same size. They're equal in size, right? They are equal in the size that they are. Now that I have equal size pieces, I can compare them and add them together and subtract them from each other, do whatever I want. Here I want to add them. How many of these 18ths do I have?
19.
19 of those 18ths.
Also 1.
Which is 1 and 1 extra 18th. I say this because there are far too many people adding 5 sixths and 2 ninths and getting 7 fifteenths. How are they getting 7 fifteenths?
They're not adding.
They're just adding. 5 plus 2 is 7. 6 plus 9 is 15. 7 fifteenths. And it really makes me sad because for some reason you never, were you never taught or did you just, you were sick that week or something and you missed out on understanding what fractions were? So we need to make them the same size so that we can put them together. And so simple. We just need things to be the same before we can add them together. They need to be the same thing. I can't add a desk to a Tyler and get two, so it doesn't make any sense. But I can add a desk to a desk and get two desks. Add 5 desks to 3 desks, get 8 desks. But I can't add 5 desks to 3 computers. It doesn't make any sense. Cool?
How'd you get 118?
Well,
we
have these things, okay? They are these things. What do I mean when I say they are these kinds of things that I've outlined? 18, okay, what does it mean to say something is an 18th? Okay, let me ask you this. So there's this thing called an 18th. If I have 18 of those 18ths, what can I make?
A whole.
Whole?
A whole.
Do you believe that?
Yeah.
Why? Okay, there's a way to help convince you that, but what this denominator means is literally what I just said. If that's that one tiny little slice, sliver of a thing, if that's an 18th, then if I put together 18 of them, I'll have a thing, one whole thing, whatever that thing is, an apple, an orange, a pie, a lasagna, a plot of land, whatever it is. If I have 18 of those things together, I'll make one. Well, how many do I have? 19. So I have enough to make how many lasagnas? I have enough to make 19 entire lasagnas?
Wait. Hey.
Let's imagine this is 1/18 of a lasagna. How many do I need to make a whole lasagna? 18. How many do I have? So how many entire lasagnas can I make?
One.
One.
Oh,
yes. One. Okay. More 18 left over.
Okay.
So I would take all those 18, so 18 of them, and slap them all together. I got one entire lasagna, but I have this little 18 left. There it is over there. It's not. One and one more 18. Let's talk about multiplying fractions. I mean, you just take a second and multiply those fractions together. Let me start with this multiplication problem, but let's put some meaning to it. Somebody tell me what I might actually take 3 of and multiply it by 4 of what? 3. What real life situation would I take a 3 and multiply it by a 4? Jasper?
If you're renting a movie that's $3 or $4 and it's a
for three for every day, and you have it for 4 days.
Okay, so it costs you $3 every day. Is that what you're saying?
Mm-hmm. And yeah.
And you're running it for 4 days.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Is it a good deal? No, it's not a good deal. But I would go to that red box. It's malfunctioning. But that absolutely makes sense. Right? We can wrap our heads around it. That is something that we might actually multiply to get a result, right? And what did we get?
12.
12 what?
Dollars.
$12. Here's what I'm trying to get you to understand, ultimately, is why we don't need common denominators when we multiply fractions together. Why do we need common denominators when we add fractions together? We need them to be the same size. When you add things together, you're collecting them into a collective, like a big pile of these things, and you're counting up how many of them you have, right? And if you're trying to count up all of them that you have, they had better be the same kind of thing. But when we multiply, do I need common denominator? Do I need them to be the same thing?
No.
Are dollars per day the same as days?
No.
No,
they're two different things. Okay. Somebody else give me an example of when I might multiply 3 times 4.
Three apples per four blocks.
Three apples per what?
Per box.
Per box. Times four.
Boxes. Correct.
More boxes. Four boxes per apple?
Oh no, the apple.
Times four apples? I'm asking you,
no.
Four what?
Boxes.
Trying to nail down what the units of this thing are. You're settling on boxes?
Yeah.
Sure. Like if you walk by a box, one box, and you look inside, what do I see inside this box?
Apples.
How many?
Three.
Three apples. I walk over to the second one. What's in this box?
Three
apples.
And another one, and what's in this box?
Three.
And another box, what's in this box?
Three.
That's 3 times 4, right? In every box, there are 3 apples, and there are 4 of those boxes. Are these the same kind of thing? Are apples per box the same as boxes?
No.
Yeah. No.
Apples are the same as apples. Boxes are the same as boxes. But apples per box, not the same as boxes.
No.
When we multiply, we oftentimes multiply two things that are not the same thing, which is different from adding. When we add the same kinds of things together, apples to apples. What would it mean if I multiplied an apple by an apple?
You get more apples. One apple, same apple.
How do I multiply an apple times an apple? What would it mean to have an apple multiplied by an apple?
It means that you would just get one apple, right? You would
well,
have...
if I add an apple to an apple, that makes sense. I got 2 apples, right? So I multiply an apple by an apple. First of all, how many do I have?
6.
One apple times one apple.
No, one apple.
One apple times one apple is one.
One square.
Yeah, if we go multiplying things by themselves, like apples times apples, we get weird things, like a square apple. And first of all, an apple is a three-dimensional object. A square is a two-dimensional object. Now this is getting weird. What's a square apple? I don't know. It seems like it should go up in dimensions. If there's a three-dimensional thing times a three-dimensional thing, it seems like it should be more dimensions than 3 dimensions. Well, it's kind of nuts. It's meaningless to multiply an apple by an apple. Rarely does it make sense to multiply a thing by the same thing. Like an inch. You can multiply an inch by an inch. What do you get? It's not a regular inch, like a ruler inch that you measure like this. Oh, there's some inches. What do you get when you multiply an inch by another inch?
A square inch.
A square inch. A completely different kind of inch. Like a two-dimensional inch. So here is an inch square, an inch times an inch. What do you get if you multiply an inch by an inch by another inch?
One
cubed.
A cubed inch. Okay, then we get an inch times an inch times another inch. We get a cubed inch. Okay, we'll draw this in 3 dimensions. A cubed inch. Now if we multiply by another inch, now it just makes no sense. 4th dimensional inch. We don't live in 4 dimensions. We live in 3 dimensions. That's the number of dimensions we experience. So to imagine for us, well, something for doctorate students, okay? You guys don't worry about four dimensions. I don't worry about four dimensions. Okay? It's enough to understand that multiplying a thing by itself, well, it makes weird things. It makes completely different things. An apple times an apple would make a completely different kind of apple, and I don't even know what that would look like. Okay?
A demented apple.
Some demented, it seems like a sixth dimension apple. Okay? Because an apple is in three dimensions, and multiplied by another apple that's in three dimensions, so she get an apple that's in six dimensions. I don't even know what that means. Okay? All of that is to remind you that when we multiply, we don't need them to be the same, so we don't need to find common denominators, because we don't need these pieces to be the same size. Okay? What I'm looking for here is just like when I had three apples per box is how we said that. Three apples per box times four boxes. Fractions, it gets a little tricky to think about, because what it's asking is, what is it like to have 5/8 apples per box and to have 9/7 boxes? That's a hard thing to wrap your head around. Okay. But what if I had 9/7, let's look at 9/7. Here's one thing, I'm gonna cut it into sevenths. Okay, so I've cut it into sevenths. How many of these sevens do I have? It's up on the board. The answer is right there on the board. How many sevens do I have? What's that?
Nine of them.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I need two more of those. Here's one. Here's another one. All right, so I have nine of them. Well, now I want to know what it's like to have 5/8 of those 9/7. Well, if I want to know what it's like to have 5/8 of something, I would need to, what do we do when we have a regular 5/8? So we take a thing and we cut it into 8 pieces, and we look at 5 of those, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? And we look at 5/8. Well, the thing we want to take 5/8 of now is this, 9/7. So I need to do the same thing though. I need to cut it into 8 pieces and look at 5 of those pieces. So you don't get two?
Yeah.
Let's cut it into 8 pieces. Well, I'll make it easy to look at by cutting it this way. All right, then I'll cut those in half. I'll cut those halves in half. I guess fourths, really. Okay. So as we look at it horizontally, how many pieces have I just cut those 9/7 into this way? Cut it into 8 pieces, right? How many of those 8 pieces do we have?
5.
So one of them, two of them, three of them, four of them, 5 of them. The things that we're talking about now are different kinds of things. They're not sevens, and they're not eights, right? The things we're talking about are these things right here. What are those things? What's that?
One.
One.
Ah,
no, they're parts of the whole. They're little tiny pieces.
Parts.
What's that? How many of these little guys does it take to make this whole thing right here? Because this is one whole.
One lasagna.
What's that?
Parts.
How many parts? How many of these does it take to make one of these?
Yeah.
Oh,
45.
Guys, it takes 45 of these?
Yeah,
to run away. 63. 63 of these?
Yeah.
I already
have
them
that day.
To make, look what I've outlined. I did not include these. Because this number is how many it takes to make a whole. The thing that I've outlined right here is the whole thing. Is one whole thing. How many of these pieces does it take?
Is this all we're having for
to make this whole thing? This way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7,
this way.
48.
Nine.
48.
You cut it in
70.
You cut it in half.
There's 7 this way and 8 this way, 56. Look at that, that's what the denominators being multiplied together tell me. It tells me I cut a thing into 7 pieces, then I cut those 7 pieces into 8 pieces, so now the new thing, this new thing, remember how we multiply inch by inch, we get a whole new thing? Multiply an apple, you get a whole new thing we don't even understand, okay? Or you multiply a dollar per day by days, you get dollars, a new kind of thing. The new thing that we're talking about here is a 56, a tiny little thing that takes 56 of them to make up that whole lasagna there. How many of those little guys do we have? We have 56?
No, we have
more. No, to start with, we had 1, 2, 3, 9 of those 7s, and then we cut them into 8s, and we only have 5 of those 8s, right? So we only have, like, 5 in this direction, and we have, in this direction, 8, 9 of them in this direction. We have 45 of them. That's what multiplying 5 by 9, multiplying the numerators together, tells me. It tells me how many of those little tiny 56s I have. So when we multiply fractions, do we need a common denominator?
Nope.
No, we don't need things to be the same before we multiply them together. We need them to be the same when we add them together. When you multiply them, we can multiply all sorts of different kinds of things by each other. Okay. Like dollars an hour times hours, two different things, turns into dollars. Dollars per hour times hours would give me dollars. And eighths by sevenths, eighths by sevenths, multiplying eighths by sevenths gives me a whole new thing and gives me 56ths. I do not have the same kind of thing that I started with. I have a new kind of thing. And how many do I have? Well, I have 5 of these things and 9 of these things. So I have 45 of these new 56 things. Right? In this case, we started out with fifths, and we're going to cut them up into 3 pieces each. So now how big are the pieces?
15.
They're 15ths now. It takes 15 of these new kinds of things to make a whole. How many of these things do we have?
48.
We had 8 of those guys there. We had 6 of these guys here. And that makes a total of 48 of these new things, these new 15ths. Well, these can be split up into 3 groups, and these can be split up into 3 groups. All right, so I can divide these both by 3.
Five.
Nine.
So having 48 of things that are size 15, it's the same as having 16 of these things that are size 1 and 5. So, adding fractions requires what? Adding fractions requires
common denominator.
Because
so they can get equal.
What's equal about them?
Same size.
The size is equal.
Yeah.
Because they need. Be the same size. They're not the same size. There's no way you could add them together. It wouldn't make any sense. Multiplying fractions, we don't need a common denominator, first of all, because when you multiply things, you don't need those things to be the same thing. In fact, it's very rare that you multiply a thing by the same kind of thing. Right? It only happens when you want to get a square kind of thing. Or a cube kind of a thing. You know what a square apple looks like, or a square desk?
Square apple.
Make any sense?
Square apple.
Right? When we multiply fractions, we multiply straight across. Okay. going on.
Mutts.
Mutts.
Multiply straight across. I went into, it's much easier to go into specifics of why we need a common denominator and what it looks like for the denominators to be the same and how denominators being the same means we have the same size pieces. All that stuff is pretty straightforward to understand. You can look at pictures, right? Marcus can draw a picture so that a fifth grader can understand what a third is, what an 18th is, right? Like what they are, okay? When we say it's an 18th, we say it's a third, we're talking about how big this thing is. When we get a common denominator, we make them same size so that we can collect them, add them together. But when we multiply fractions, I did show you what it looks like to multiply two fractions together. It's a little more lofty than out there, okay? I will remind you that you need to find a common denominator when you add and subtract fractions. And I will, as many times as you ask me, like in the hallway, to explain why we multiply straight across on fractions, I will explain it over and over and over because I want you to understand. I want you to know the truth, okay? But that truth is a little harder to understand than this truth. So I won't always drive this home. I'll remind you, when you multiply fractions, multiply straight across, okay? Nothing to get confused about. Just remember that you multiply straight across. At least you'll get the right answer. You may not understand what you're doing or why, but at least you'll get the right answer. Multiply straight across. We do not cross multiply. That's completely out. And if you can simplify it at the end, and you can divide by the same thing, you can take out a common factor, good. Okay. So I don't want to see any more, right? Let's say I hope not to see any more 2/3 plus 5/8 equals 7/11. No, that's not equal to each other. We need common denominators, but we need them to be the same kind of thing. We need them to be the same size. All right? It's going to turn into homework if we don't get it done today, but it's just two graphs, okay? The reason why I'm going over all this multiplying fractions and adding fractions is because part of the graphing, and we are having some trouble with graphing, maybe it's because we don't understand fractions. There's lots of fractions in graphing. So, it's worth our time to go back and revisit fractions, okay? So, we've got enough time to at least get this one started. We've got one more over here that I want you to do as well. Let's start with this one. Let's just see what you do with it. I'm not going to tell you what to do, just see what you do with it. Okay, so to maintain this telling you the truth about math, I want to never not tell you the truth about a graph. And that is that a graph is made of what? Graph is a picture. Pictures aren't made of numbers.
Dots.
Dots. Made of dots, which in math we call points. We call them points.
What's the other one?
We're doing this right now. I'll show you the other one. Apple. Right. Okay. So it's made of what?
Dots.
Okay. Now, here's a point. Okay. Does it belong to this graph?
Maybe.
The graph of this equation? Maybe it does. How will we know if it does?
We have to solve.
What does that mean?
The equation.
Solve it. How do I solve this equation?
You put 5 in for x.
Oh, put 5 in for x, because the thing that makes this point, is that it is here and it is here at the same time. It's 5 to the right and 9 above the origin. Okay,